The forum is dedicated to what at times sometimes seems, at least today, like a rather audacious proposition. And that proposition is simply this, that thoughtful, engaging, engaged, rigorous, and respectful debate remains possible even in this era of intense partisanship. In the face of discourse around us that sometimes seems to be anything but reasoned, the Janus Forum maintains that reasoned discourse nevertheless does remain possible. The forum believes that the academy should preference deliberation over knee-jerk reactions, that engaging an opponent's argument is always superior to and frankly more interesting than ad hominem attacks, and in fact, that there is deep satisfaction and even joy to be found in debate. In short, the forum aims to model the kinds of diversity of thought that amplifying our impact, our strategic vision, commits itself into the proposition that healthy debate is fundamental between, in the words of our amplifying our impact, education and healthy democracy. We're fortunate to have two distinguished speakers to debate this year's resolution, and that resolution stated in full is, social media should be more regulated. Jim Steyer from Common Sense Media on your right is going to argue for the resolution, and John Samples from the Cato Institute to your left is going to argue against the resolution. We're going to follow the ABBA or ABBA format. This is not the Swedish pop group, but it simply refers to the order of argumentation. So Jim Steyer will offer remarks in favor of the resolution. Samples will then respond. He will offer his remarks. And to conclude, Jim Steyer will respond to John Samples. So just a couple of words about our guests. Jim Steyer is the founder and chief executive of Common Sense Media, a nonpartisan organization dedicated to providing trustworthy information and education and families. Three of his books are especially relevant to our topic today. The first, Talking Back to Facebook, which was published in 2012. Second, yeah, that's right. He's very prescient. Second, The Other Parent, The Inside Story of Media's Effect on Our Children, published in 2002. And most recently, published in 2020, Which Side of History? How Technology is Reshaping Democracy in Our Lives. Jim is a consulting professor at the Stanford University School of Education. He began his career as a law clerk for Justin Allen Broussard of the California Supreme Court. You may have heard or seen him on the Oprah Winfrey Show, The Today Show, Good Morning America, Fresh Air, the CBS Morning Show, CNN, Fox News, and MSNBC. John Samples, on your left, is vice president at the Cato Institute. He founded and he now directs Cato's Center for Representative Government, which studies First Amendment government institutional failure and public opinion. John serves on Facebook's oversight board, which provides final and binding decisions on whether specific content should be allowed or removed from Facebook and Instagram. John is currently working on a book-length manuscript. He tells me it's coming to a conclusion about social media and speech regulation. That manuscript extends the policy analysis that he proffered in an earlier publication titled, Why the Government Should Not Regulate Content Moderation of Social Media. You may have heard or read John's commentary in USA Today, the New York Times, the Los Angeles Times, or seen or heard him on NPR, Fox News, and MSNBC. So welcome, Jim and John. So let's begin. I'm going to turn the podium over to Jim, who will open with observations in favor of the resolution, and then I'll invite John to respond.
All right, thank you guys for coming. I have a rule that I do in my I have a teacher class at Stanford with 1,500 students, and I have a rule. You are not allowed to have one of these apps while I'm speaking, and I will literally go into the audience and take it away from you. So I'm going to have that rule when I talk today too, called device-free discussion. But thank you so much, Bryn, for the introduction. Mr. President, Madam Provost, everybody else. It's great to be here in Vermont. I hope we have a really fun discussion today. And I'm really looking forward to the question and answer period and also hearing from John. I'm taking my watch off, so I'll follow the rules on the time. So here's how I'd start. I would tell you this, social media is basically having a tobacco moment right now. And that's really what's going on in America today. I was spending a lot of time in the last week or so commenting on the hearings they had last week on social media in front of Congress, since we're the biggest child advocacy group and tech advocacy group in the United States, if not the world. And if you watch the hearings, you really saw something that was sort of reminiscent of what we saw 30 years ago when the tobacco industry executives were hauled in front of Congress and where they hemmed and hawed and tried nuanced statements about how tobacco is not addictive and why it really wasn't that harmful to kids, but fundamentally led to a phenomenal change in public health in the United States and the way that we looked at both tobacco and cigarette smoking, particularly among young people, but in general. And the reason I mention that is because I think we're at exactly the same point when it comes to social media. And if you think about it, my friend Vivek Murthy, who's the Surgeon General of the United States, he's the Surgeon General under President Obama, and he's the current Surgeon General again, came out about 6 months ago and put out a warning that said that social media is unhealthy and has a deeply correlative relationship to the youth mental health crisis in the United States. And one of the things that I would start out by saying in the context of my remarks, and I think every young person in the audience knows this, is that we are actually going through a youth mental health crisis in the United States right now. And social media is one of the biggest factors in it. If you watch the circus-like hearings last week on television, you could have seen some senators parading up there and referring to the CEOs of Instagram. Actually, Zuck from Facebook was there, but Snapchat, Discord, and others. Lindsey Graham said they have blood on their hands. And I would say, in general, as the father of four kids and the head of the largest media and tech advocacy group in the United States, that we've allowed technology companies to run amok for about the last 20 years. That's why I wrote Talking Back in Facebook in 2012, Bryn. But by that point, it was clear to me, I actually think the book was not that good a book, but prescient, which said what's going on with young people in this country is not okay. And I think 12 years later, the chickens have come home to roost. And there are two reasons that I feel that social media has to be regulated and why we play a very big role in that. And I'm happy to talk about that in my remarks, but also in questions. First, there is a huge body of research, evidence from whistleblowers, polls, and most of all, from academic researchers around the world that proves that social media is simply not safe for kids, but it is a broader public health issue for all of us. And I include the people in this room and adults as well as young people. Second, having worked with the leaders of the companies for well over 15 years, I would tell you that they have resisted every opportunity to take meaningful voluntary action to make their products safe and healthy for the broader public, and particularly for kids and teens, and the broader citizenry has suffered dramatically as a result. And my hope is after we have this debate is that you won't just agree with me, but you'll also be motivated to do something to change that for this state of Vermont, for the community of Burlington, and most of all, for the kids and families of America. So why do I say that social media is a major public health issue and a major cause of damage and harm to young people in particular, but to all of us? Well, first of all, and I'll walk just through some of the research briefly, there is a growing body of evidence over the last decade or so that shows the impact of social media and the platforms in particular on the mental health of America and the people around the world, and particularly young people, on social, emotional, and behavioral well-being of young people, and quite frankly, of many adults. It's a big contributor to physical harm, which I'll talk about in a second. It's had an extraordinary impact on our democratic norms and institutions. And it's also, in many cases, eviscerated norms of personal privacy that when I was in college, I took for granted. And as a law professor at Stanford, I will tell you that privacy is a fundamental right under the US Constitution. And that the examples are myriad. First of all, social media has been shown over and over again to be addictive. That's why I told you not to bring your phones out, because you'll be looking down at them all the time, because it leads to addictive and compulsive behavior, particularly among people with vulnerable, underdeveloped brains. It also exposes people to dangerous content. It also exposes people to misleading and completely dishonest content in the context of elections and democratic discourse. And the lack of regulation in this country, which has lagged behind Europe and the rest of the world in terms of regulation, has basically led to a virtual lab experiment on our society and particularly on the social, emotional, and cognitive well-being of young people. So let me give you some examples. Teens who use social media regularly report feeling loneliness, depression, and anxiety at far higher levels. So the CDC's biannual youth risk survey, most recent one, showed that 7% of teen girls now say that they experience persistent sadness or hopelessness, and that's up from 35% in 2011. 30% of teen girls now say they have considered suicide seriously, up from 19% in 2011. Those who use social media for more than 3 hours a day face double the risk of depression and anxiety syndromes. And that's a big deal when you realize that the average teenager spends 3.5 hours a day using social media. If kids are actually prone to depression, the impact of that media can be deadly. Among girls with depressive symptoms, 7 in 10 who use Instagram and TikTok regularly say they come across problematic suicide-related content at least monthly. Introduction of Facebook likely is responsible for the increase of depression among students. As we saw the rollout of Facebook on college campuses for young people, Facebook used to be for kids, not now it is for adults, as before my students at Stanford started Instagram and sold it to Zuckerberg. But you can see an absolute trend of correlation between the development of Facebook in particular, but some of the other big social media platforms, and suicides and anxiety and depression, et cetera. And there's a big issue around student health, and I would argue that if the head of the UVM Medical Center were here today, they would have lots to say about the impact of social media on the health and well-being of young people here at UVM. So, by the way, the other thing that you see all the time, I see this in my students and my own 4 children, is that teens who use social media also report problems with distraction and lack of focus. They pick up their phones on the average more than 100 times a day and typically receive over 237 notifications daily. I'm sure that's true for a number of you in this room. 97% of students in America spend time on their phone during school hours scrolling. I know professors at UVM don't know that, but I do, and the students do too. 45% of teen girls who use TikTok say they feel addicted to it. Teen girls spend over 2 hours a day on average in the United States on YouTube and TikTok, and 90 minutes a day on the other platforms. That's how you get the 3.5 hours a day. They have also been strongly correlated with low self-esteem, eating disorders, poor body image, anorexia, many other basic fundamental public health issues in this country. And we've seen 42% of school health workers in the United States who were surveyed last year said they'd seen an uptick in eating disorders since 2019, maybe related to the pandemic, but also clearly related to social media. Okay, let's talk about physical harm. Teens and all of us are sold drugs and weapons on social media platforms. That's where you buy fentanyl. That's where you buy ghost guns. And I'm gonna talk about California and the laws that we've written there in a minute. But according to the USDEA, drug traffickers have turned smartphones into a one-stop shop market to sell, buy, and deliver deadly fake prescription pills and other dangerous drugs. As I said, the fentanyl crisis in my hometown of San Francisco is oftentimes played out on social media platforms. Criminal networks use those platforms. That includes, by the way, not just selling real fentanyl, but fake fentanyl, methamphetamine pills, often to unsuspecting young people who don't really know what they're buying. Investigations from the Washington Post and New York Times have shown the proliferation of ghost guns being bought online on platforms like Snapchat, TikTok, YouTube, and most of all, Instagram. And girls receive constant contact from unwanted strangers. According to a recent Pew Research study, 1 in 4 girls have reported contact from someone they did not know that made them feel scared or uncomfortable. In addition, CSAM, something that we just wrote a law about in California that we'll see if it passes in 24, child sexual abuse material. Instagram connects a vast pedophile network And that has been brought out by whistleblowers at Facebook and Instagram. My friend Francis Haugen, who was the first big whistleblower at Facebook, exposed this, as well as the evisceration of the content moderation teams at Facebook, leading to efforts to undermine democracy. But they also show now the impact of the platforms of Facebook and Instagram. There's a new Arturo Bejar, who's the second new Facebook whistleblower in the last 6 months, showed that the algorithms were promoting illicit, with the knowledge of the guys who run Instagram, were promoting illicit content, explicit hashtags, which connect users to accounts with child sexual abuse materials, and that Instagram allows users to search for terms that its own algorithms well know contain harmful and illegal content. Okay, democracy, oh, there's been no impact of social media on democracy, except for on the 2016 election in the United States and every single election since then. And there will be a massive impact on the 24 election, whether it's here in Vermont or at the national level. And with the advent of AI and the proliferation of AI, you will see that on steroids. A 2020 study from the NAS, the National Academy of Sciences, said that false information spread 6 times faster than true information on platforms like Twitter, also known as X. And now that Elon, the great Elon, has eviscerated the content moderation team at Twitter X, just wait till you see what happens. It's a virtual sewer now of content because they eliminated the content moderation team. Social media doesn't just connect people, it creates echo chambers. It creates filter bubbles. It allows you to just live in your little world and just hear your own little Fox News clips or maybe your very liberal clips or whatever, but it has really undermined social and societal discourse. Foreign manipulation, disinformation campaigns pose a direct threat to our democracy. The evidence about the impact of Russia during the 2016 election, the Trump-Hillary Clinton election has legions of evidence. And you now see in 24 is probably gonna be the biggest year for elections, not just the momentous election in the United States, but in elections all around the world. And misinformation and disinformation campaigns will be rife, and they will largely be existing on social media platforms. And basically what that has done, trust in traditional media institutions and broader institutions, including university, erodes. So that's the bad stuff. But here's the second corollary to that. You cannot trust large technology companies to police themselves. That's like literally the fox guarding the chicken coop. And I have spent 15 years running the biggest advocacy group in the country, watching them get up in front of Congress or the California legislature or the EU legislature in Brussels, talking about all the safety regulations and all the stuff they do. But the fact is that the basic business model of social media is to have you, is an arms race for your attention, particularly for young people's attention. Social media apps make money by selling you. You are the product to advertisers. We actually ran a bill in California called You Are the Product, so that you would understand that it's your information, your personal private information that's being sold. But that business model therefore leads to addiction, attention, distraction issues, like I mentioned, the evisceration of privacy norms that we used to take for granted, and basically the evisceration of social guardrails that used to exist. What do companies do now when we pass laws in California like the 2018 privacy law, that's the law of the land in the United States, the CCPA? They file lawsuits immediately in court. They will get up and say nice things in front of the cameras, but they will do anything they can to prevent regulation of their products. Imagine if that was a car or Boeing or some of the other companies who have huge impacts on our public health. And we saw this, as I said, in my friend Arturo Bejar, the recent whistleblower from Facebook, who came out and documented in great detail the efforts of Facebook to undermine regulatory efforts across the board in the United States and in Europe. So, proprietary safety practices and content that the companies claim are effective simply are a mirage. If you have spent a lot of time adjusting your kids' safety standards and on Instagram or TikTok, please put up your hand, because nobody does that. And so what I would tell you is according to Arturo's testimony in front of Congress a couple months ago, 1 in 8 users under the age of 16 on Instagram said they experienced sexual advances on the platform, that Facebook and Instagram knew that, but did nothing about it. As I said, my friend Francis Haugen showed the same kind of testimony in front of Congress in 2021. And so that's sort of the basic picture. Here's sort of the bottom line for what needs to be done. If you may know, Europe has regulated these platforms much more than the United States. And I'll talk, I teach civil rights and civil liberties at Stanford, so I'm happy to talk about First Amendment and the interplay between the First Amendment and some of these regulations. But Europe passed GDPR. We passed the California privacy law. Europe just passed the DSA, which is essentially regulating social media platforms for harmful content. We passed that in California. We also passed the Age Appropriate Design Code. By the way, there is something, and I'm sure that we'll hear about it in the discussion today. There is a law written in 1996, the Communications Decency Act, written by Senator Ron Wyden of Oregon, which put in a section 230 that gave basic immunity to social media platforms in the earliest days of the internet so that it wouldn't stifle innovation. That law was written when Mark Zuckerberg was in diapers and a number of the students here weren't alive. And it has never been updated. And it is a basic get out of jail free card for the tech industry. And it's a disgrace. And it could be modified or abolished. And what we can talk about that in the question and answer period. The other thing is, age restrictions, as all the young people in the audience know, don't actually work. There's no age verification theme. You can go on a platform and say whatever age you are. They, even though they're trillion-dollar companies, they've never actually built in an age verification system because they've never been held accountable. And I will tell you this. Your kids, my kids, our society are never going to be safe until these large companies are regulated. Period. Full stop. Do not kid yourself. 80% of the public, again, I run the biggest advocacy group in the country on these issues, Republican, Democrat, conservative, liberal, rural, urban, doesn't matter. People want regulation of these platforms. Why aren't they regulated? Because they are so rich and powerful, and they spend hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars on lobbying, on buying off public spokespeople from nonprofits that they create, and by putting out a false version of the products and the practices of their platforms. And so even despite the extraordinary public sentiment on our side, we've had nothing from Congress in the last 25 years. They've been missing in action. So the bottom line for me is pretty clear. Social media has undermined, 1, our basic public health norms. 2, the social and emotional well-being of millions of young people here in the United States, including a couple of my own children at different times. 3, many of the most treasured norms and democratic institutions of our society and across the world. 4, the fundamental right to privacy in the United States and globally. 5th, and perhaps most important, the health and well-being of our youngest citizens, the next generation of American leaders. The time has come for fundamental change. And I will tell you, we will win, and the biggest winners will be children and youth. I will go on, I could tell you stories about moms, dads, teachers, young people who are part of the 200 million people who use Common Sense Media every year, who come in and talk about the depression of their 13-year-old, the suicide of their 15-year-old, the exposure to porn or CSAM of their 8-year-old. All of them live those experiences on a regular basis. And by the way, all of us live the deterioration of our democratic norms and institutions. So it is time that we stop putting faith in a handful of irresponsible billionaire tech executives, many of whom have never thought through the products that they created and put onto the market, and start agreeing that we need to regulate the social media platforms, which, while they provide value, also cause tremendous harm to our citizenry and our kids in particular. Senator Klobuchar last week said in the hearing, when a Boeing plane lost a door in mid-flight, nobody questioned the decision to ground a fleet of over 700 planes immediately. So why aren't we taking the same kind of decisive action when it comes to the harms and damage caused by social media platforms? At the end of the day, my message to you guys is clear. It's up to all of us to join this fight. We will win, but we will only win when all of you get involved. And you will win because we have truth, justice and the American way on our side. And by the way, the biggest winners of all will be America's children and youth. Thank you very much. Take it away.
Thank you. I was realizing I wasn't sure if this is like a symphony and we're allowed to applaud between movements, but apparently we are. So we will ask our next speaker to respond and to offer his thoughts.
So the one thought I first thought is I find it odd to try to imagine Mark Zuckerberg as a 10-year-old in diapers, right? Section 230 dates from 1996. He's about 10 years older than that. And I understand he's he went from a figure of, general approbation prior to when. What date did the turn come on the social media companies? I can tell you exactly when the date came. Early November 2016. What happened in early November 2016? Donald Trump was elected president, in part through his efforts on Facebook, which a Facebook executive who is generally recognized as credible said he had written the best marketing stuff that he'd ever seen. So maybe the problem is the people on Facebook, and this is the Section 230 idea, that people are responsible for their behavior on Facebook rather than making Facebook into a semi-government. So what I want to do is respond and give we have general kinds of disagreements here, and I want to respond and try to get those general. But what I want most of all to do today is to speak to the young people in this room, because what I would like to convey, if you forget everything else besides what a great speaker Jim is, that what you remember is about the things I'm about to say about how to think about politics, how to think about public policy. And so I'm going to start with the public health issue and then come back to the democracy issue, okay? And let me check the time so I don't go over. So let's begin with the public health issue. I'm going to start in an odd sort of analogy that you might find, but keep in mind, I'm coming back to what Jim said and the questions of public health that are with us right now, as he said, in Washington. So let's begin with an issue that is also bedeviling Washington at this moment. That is to say, one way to think about it, immigration policy. The other is the southern border. Okay, let me give you a stylized idea about the southern border that you probably recognize, and indeed about immigration. Some people say, and I think you know who these people are, say that the southern border is open, right? And that two kinds of people come over to do harms to America, to Americans. One are terrorists, and the other are criminals, right? And they are let into the country, and they do what they want to do. Now, just to be straight up with you, the argument's much more complicated than this, although sometimes it does seem like it isn't. But my point is a different one. Imagine that you could actually seal the border. Think about that. You sealed it in such a way that whatever terrorists there were and whatever criminals there were, or people, you know, in a kind of bizarre way, people who are going to commit crimes, let's say people who have a high tendency to commit crimes, were the border was sealed in a way that they could not get in. Okay, so those problems are avoided. What are the other consequences of sealing the border? Well, if you believe as I do, and I think actually this is not really very argued against, most of the people coming into the United States, even if they say they're asylum seekers, most of those people are here to do what? They're seeking a better life for themselves and their family. They're attracted to the most dynamic economy on earth, one that actually offers them real opportunity, right? And people don't tell you, well, if we seal the border, we keep out those dynamic entrepreneurs and hardworking people that want to make a better life for themselves. You can see why they don't tell you, right? Now, here's my general point about public health, and it's a general point about public policy that I would like to leave you with if you forget everything else I say. It is that when you make public policy, you do more than one thing. You can do some things, and you can have true positives that prevent harms, but you also do other things that are false positives that have costs to the society. And in this particular case, we'll see exactly, this is an important point for this area, because what is actually being proposed in terms of regulation goes by another name. At Meta, it's called voice. In the United States in general, it's called speech or expression, right? And you have to keep in mind, we live in a country in which the regulation of laws, and God knows Congress needs it, is governed by the First Amendment, which says Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech. Now, in detail, in judicial doctrine, here's what that means. It means that anytime Congress regulates, chills, or suppresses, censors speech on the basis of its content, courts are going to make it subject to strict scrutiny. And this means that the government has to have a really strong interest, compelling interest, and it has to narrowly tailor the policy to that, achieving that interest, right? Now, Jim says that Congress has done nothing in this area. In fact, that's not true. Congress has already regulated the internet in pursuit of child welfare before, in the 1990s, in laws that were designed to prevent children from being harmed by the actual origins of it was online porn, or really what in the First Amendment context is speech that has no protection under the First Amendment. There are certain categories of speech that aren't protected. One of them is obscenity. So Congress has moved in the area where its strongest case can be made that it can censor speech. Obscenity has no First Amendment protections under our Constitution. And yet, those laws, two of which were passed in the mid-90s, were both struck down by the Supreme Court. And as Jim mentioned, part of it was also Section 230, and Section 230 survived. And it turned out to be the only regulation that survived from that period. So here's the problem, I think, that's part of the issue. Now, let me go back to the question of harms. And Jim gave you a very broad understanding of those. Now, this goes to the question of social science and its ability to try to determine causality and whether treatments cause something or not, which is hard to do across the board, right? But and in this area, like many others, social science doesn't give one answer. I would want to give you a couple of other alternatives to what Jim discussed. There's a professor named Andrew Schibelsky, who works in the field of psychology and technology. He's at Oxford University. And his general work has shown that the thesis that social media is inherently harmful to teenagers and children is too broad and too simple. There's a great complexity, he says, between digital technology and youth well-being. The effect is not uniformly harmful, and it is influenced by a variety of factors. His research has found that a moderate use of digital technology is not intrinsically harmful and may be beneficial in certain contexts, indicating that the relationship between screen time and well-being is not linear, but follows a more nuanced pattern. Go back to the idea of false positives. A nuanced pattern is going to be hard to deal with in public policy. He has also found that the amount of time, he has looked at the amount of time and how it's related to psychological well-being. The associations are often small, and other factors such as sleep, family environment, and bullying play a more significant role in youth well-being than screen time alone. He argues that the narrative of widespread harm from social media overlooks the positive aspects of digital engagement, such as social support, learning opportunities, and community building. So his emphasis is, yes, there are harms for some, but there's also things that digital technology offers that are good, and that there's an importance to context here. I would also cite a literature review from 2020 by two leading professors, Odgers and Jensen, who looked at all of the studies that had been done up to that time on this issue and concluded that there were few effects of social media on adolescents one way or other, that many of them, and this is one of the bedeviling things with social science, only a few of them could distinguish cause and effect. What that means is, well, one thesis is that social media causes people to report feeling bad, but feeling bad can also cause people to use social media, right? And so when you're doing a study, you have to distinguish those two, or you've got the causality wrong. The research overview I've mentioned concluded that the results are of little, the results on these studies are of little clinical or practical use. So there's a really strong reasons that, you know, it's not just John Haidt, if you follow John, maybe John's a good guy, maybe it's right. It's actually much more nuanced than that. The Schabelsky's work involves studies of panel studies, which are not exactly the gold standard, but they're pretty good, of 84,000 people in England, right? And if you don't find significant effects with that kind of numbers, it means the effects are pretty small, which is also what you see in the... Now, I'm going to be true to our person who introduced us today by talking about another side of Schabelsky's work and some of his colleagues, which is this 84,000 person study. It was in Nature. And the conclusion there is that they found that girls experience a negative link between social media use and life satisfaction when they are 11 to 13 years old, and boys when they are 14 to 15. Now, I rush to note this is too categorical. What they found in the data was that there was some significant effects for those two groups, not for all teens, not for everyone that was studied, but for these groups. So in terms of nuance, what I'm trying to, again, be nuanced in here is tell you that there are groups that this person I have cited about the general effects has found, in fact, do report, well, basically it's usually self-reporting, that they are unhappy. But one of his colleagues says, our statistical modeling examines averages. And so some people, even in those groups, are going to experience negative effects, but others are going to have a positive impact. And what's overlooked in all of these discussions, because of the way advocacy goes and because of the Congress has an issue where it wants to do something that they can agree on, and one of the few things they can agree on, I mean, who's for help harming children? I'm not. And certainly it's an easy thing. The other thing they legislated, and you said there's no regulation. What they did was, the other regulation they did, which was done, this is my thing. I really want procedures and stuff, and I want you to follow your procedures. You send stuff through committees if you're Congress and you find out what the issue is. No, they found out that an online magazine was being used for, now here we come to a language issue. It was used for either prostitution or sex workers, and I'll leave that to you to decide. So guess what? You got legislation, very, very strong legislation regulating that. to prevent it from being used. And of course, sex trafficking was brought into this too. The problem with that was, this is the regulation that doesn't exist. The problem was that sex workers were using the internet to be safer, right? That is, they could screen clients, then they wouldn't be out on the street and dealing with people they don't know and getting themselves killed, frankly. Now, Congress was told this, and what do you think Congress did? Now, what is the analogy here? We have to look at the positive effects. The internet is also used for positive things. So I would also say, finally, because this is an issue, the American Psychological Association has observed, quote, using social media is not inherently beneficial or harmful to young people. Some people, and there's a developmental issue here, and some people, it's very good for them. They're both for stress or the interaction itself can be good. But it does seem that in Schabelsky's work that we at least see some groups that are. Now, why is that a problem? And I have to mention one other thing here. Social media addiction is not a recognized syndrome, right? It's a term of rhetorical art that people use in policy. The psychiatric associations that have charge of that, the DSM does not recognize it, okay? So if we want to go that way by the expertise, we're not going to be talking about addiction here. So I want to move on quickly here. As always, time somehow seems short for me. So let's go to the issue. You have actually a very specific piece of legislation in front of us, which is the kids online. I forget these things. The kids, COSA, the Kids Online
Protection. Safety Act.
Safety Act, of course, safety. How could I miss that? Which has a very broad duty of care for companies to prevent harm to teens. Now, that means they have to find out who are the teens and protect them from and prevent them from hearing or seeing certain kinds of expression, right? It's part of it. That's a vague requirement that's going to require them inevitably, I think, to be overly broad. They want to avoid the punishments that are in the bill. They were going to want to make sure that no kids get to see things. And what that means is that adults as well as kids are going to be blocked on what they can see online. Now that's a problem because remember what I said about the First Amendment. That's an overly broad law that is going to actually affect the rights of adults as well as children. And by the way, and maybe I'm not sure about this, but maybe some of you in this room can appreciate this more. It turns out that people under 18 years of old have First Amendment rights. They have rights to see content also. And they have had such rights for 55 years under the Supreme Court. So again, you've got this problem. There is a real First Amendment problem. It has to be, any kind of legislation has to be a compelling public interest, which you could say that maybe kids' health is going to fit that, but then it has to be designed and well-tailored. What we're seeing here is that the kids who actually are, this is why we go back to immigration, right? We're building a wall, as it were, metaphorically, about expression online that reaches both the kids that 15 to 17, 13 to 15 that I've mentioned, and reaches everyone else. All kids will be affected by this, and many adults. That's where the pornography, the bills, the earlier regulations went to die at the Supreme Court because of overreach, right? And also questions about obscenity. So this question is, I think, will be well beyond that. The question of trying to find out whether people are minors or not. The verification part has been taken out because people worried about the loss of anonymous statements, right? Anonymous expression online. But here is another issue that I think is real. This is with Kids Online Safety Act. It's going to be enforced by state attorney generals. One of its sponsors, Marsha Blackburn of Tennessee, a senator, has said that providing information to trans kids about sexual development, about transsexuality, does harm to those children. So who do you think is going to be, in some states, at some places, is going to actually find that they can't find information online about being gay, about being trans, or whatever, right? Remember the immigration, who is going to be kept out? Who is going to lose out from this? It's pretty evident that, to me, going into this, that that is going to be a serious problem. Now, I'm running out of time, and democracy is a big issue. I want, and as we can continue this as we go, one thing I would say is it's important to remember that Donald Trump's victory is not a sign that the world is coming to an end or the democracy is coming. He can be defeated in the normal ways, right? That's one thing. The other thing is the problems that are mentioned here about false information online. I come from Washington, D.C. I have never met anyone in Washington, D.C. who had strong partisan views that thought the other side was, well, they're just disagree with me, but they're trying hard. No, the other side was always and everywhere lying. They were spreading falsehoods, right? So what do you think, you start looking out for misinformation, disinformation, and so on, where is that going to end? You have to tolerate a certain amount of misinformation, for a lack of another word. And Meta does that in the following way. Misinformation does come down at Meta, and remember they're not covered by the First Amendment, but it has to do other harms. It has to foster violence, for example, or it has to foster discrimination against minority groups, which is another example of, well, self-regulation can't be, hasn't taken place, but it is. It's taking place now by the people who actually know something about the platform. So I think it's very dangerous and very undemocratic to start talking about false information per se. The censor is not supposed to be Mark Zuckerberg or Marsha Blackburn. The censor is supposed to be you and what you see online. If you can't handle false information, then the whole undertaking is misplaced. Liberal democracy is misplaced, right? You have to realize that. It's unfortunate. It's also evident most of the time, stupid stuff that's very clearly either satire or falsehood. And so there's that. There's many things here, Jim, that you've talked about, and you've spread me wide here, but I have to talk about one, which is the European Union and democracy. So here's what likely will happen in the next, at least it's a possibility. I don't know how likely it is. United States is a country that has a series of political institutions. You may want to call them, as I do, liberal democracy, you may not. But it has these institutions. It has a speech policy that's governed by the First Amendment. European speech policies are much less protective, much more willing to see and to countenance restrictions on speech, right? So it's different. That doesn't mean they're not, in some sense, a liberal democracy, but it's different, and they have these organizations and courts and the European Union that have made these policies. Now, the problem is this. Once DSA goes into effect, they have something called systemic harms that will be banned from the platforms. The platforms, Meta and the others too, pursue a policy of one rule for the entire platform, generally speaking, except for Germany, where the Germans passed a law that made them not do that. But generally, they do that. So what does that mean? It means the Europeans have passed a law about speech that is going to be applied to Americans online on Facebook. How is that democratic? American users of Facebook are going to find their speech rights are determined in Brussels, or one of those sort of fake towns they have over there, and not here in the United States. How is that democratic? Why should we live under a European regime? Right? In, what's that? 3 minutes. That's more than I thought. I'd finished up. The other, the 230 has been much, Jim mentions that in passing. 230 is simply the idea that was also connected to free speech in the following way. What free 230, section 230 says is if I do, if I libel you, if I libel Jim, which I would never do, by the way, if I libel Jim by, I don't know how I would do that, but if I did do that online, it's up to me, it's on me, it's not on Facebook. Now, the reason this wasn't a concession to Facebook, that this was done by, after all, the senator in question was very much a man of the left. It was done because the fear that if you Facebook itself was governing that kind of thing, that you told Facebook, look, you're going to be liable unless you take down all anything that could be libelous, right? If you did that, they were going to say, oh, no, let's just take no chances. Let's take no chances and let's get speech that's libelous, that speech that might be libelous, the gray zone speech, and you know what? Pick up some of the speech that's clearly in a protected zone too. Because we don't want to have to deal with all the litigation and the liability. So Section 230 is actually something to prevent overbreath by the companies themselves. Can the company, I'll finish with this, can the companies be trusted? And if you have a theory that that companies are, you know, basically malevolent and that the profit motive is pursued in a very very marginal or very immediate way, then, and you could come up with theories about why they are to be trusted. And indeed, you have to also think about it from their point of view. They don't want to lose control of the company and give it over to either or highly organized interest or to politicians in Congress, which you know, have reached new lows of appalling speech, as we saw. So the question is, what does maximizing shareholder value, after all, the person that's forgotten is the people that own the damn company, right? What does that mean? What does it require of the managers? And I think it means, first of all, you've got to manage the brand well, you've got to manage it over time so that you've created a company. We know from the, and I hope I get support from this from some business professors here, that investments themselves are done over time. It's not just immediate investments or quarterly investments that matter. And so the brand matters a lot and the companies care. What happened in Washington, the demagoguery of last week, was very harmful to the company. Facebook's brand has been harmed by being involved in politics, and they are in the process of getting out of it now as much as they can. But that is what they are concerned about. They have every reason. When you ask about public policy and its consequences, this is my final point, always ask the question, what are the incentives? And if you know the incentives, you have a theory about what the likely consequences are going to be. Thank you. And thanks for Jim for not taking my iPad during, this is not a phone, this is something important.
Yeah. Right. Do I get 2 minutes?
You do.
I'll get two minutes, and then I want to get to the audience.
I do too.
I want to get to you guys, so I'll be very quick.
Down, I can remind you that you have on your seat a card if you have a question for our speakers. When Jim is done, please start filling them out now, and somebody will be collecting them so we can shuffle them in.
Okay, so I'm really interested in hearing what you all want to say. You can ask any question you want. Let me just make a few points. First of all, to John's point that that tech and media have very beneficial impacts in society, that's obviously true. I run the biggest kids media group in the country. People love Common Sense because we tell you all the good stuff you can find on tech, on media, et cetera. So obviously we believe that's true. That being said, the demonstrable harms of social media, which is the point of the debate today, are so obvious and the evidence is so clear and convincing that I could spend 3 hours here listening all the studies. One thing I would say though, it's important, John brought up the issue of causation. No one is saying that for all the youth mental health crisis, just take that issue, or the decline of democracy, or any of the other really important harms we're talking about here today, are completely caused solely by social media. Are they one of the biggest contributing factors, if not the most? Absolutely they are. But there is no question that you can't just put the onus only on a handful of trillion-dollar social media platforms. Absolutely right about Congress's dysfunctionality. I think that was the point you were making about when you're talking about the border and everything else, because they haven't been able to do anything about basically anything. But I will tell you that despite Congress's pathetic dysfunctionality over 30 years, there's been tremendous regulation that has occurred. And by the way, it's occurred largely in the state level. That's why we write the laws in Sacramento, and we're writing them right now in Albany. We have never done it here in Vermont, but that was because you don't want 10, 50 different laws. But you do we do regulate the companies at the state level in the United States. And Europe, when Europe passes laws, they pass laws that are not designed to restrict speech in America. They're designed to regulate the companies in Europe. And we have an office in Brussels, and those laws are very carefully thought through. There are differences between First Amendment standards in Europe than there are here. But I will tell you that every single law we've written at Common Sense and have been to this date have been upheld. I'm a First Amendment law professor. I value free speech and free expression more than anything, and I teach a class to Stanford undergrads for the last 28 years on it. And so we always balance First Amendment speech protections with the best interests of society, and that's what all the case law is. It's a balancing act. Look, at the end of the day, everybody in this room knows the fundamental transformation that has occurred in our society over the past 20 years, whether it's in terms of public health, our civil discourse, our democracy, and other things. The fact that social media has had such a negative impact on so many elements of that is indisputable. The question is, how do we find common sense, thoughtful, well-crafted regulation that reins in the excesses and still permits the rest of us and all of us to have the free and good society we have? We've been doing that. The momentum is on our side. 90% of the public agrees with this approach. I've written off Congress, and I will write them off in 2024, but I will not write off you, and I will not write off the idea that we can find common sense, thoughtful, consistent ways to deal with public health concerns, to deal with the future of our democracy, and to deal with the best interests of young people. At the end of the day, that's what this is about, and that's why I strongly believe that if you look at the question, and the question was, yes or no, should social media be regulated to protect and promote the best interests of democracy, public health, and personal privacy? The answer is a no-brainer. Obviously it should be, and it will be, and the time has come. Thank you very much, and I'd love to hear your questions.
So if you have a question, please raise your hand. Michelle will come and collect the cards, and if I can read them, I will.
Okay. How can we argue for the choice and discernment of social media users, young or old, when we cede these decisions to the platform's algorithms? For example, it's hard to make the case that users can recognize the absurd when the feed only provides the absurd.
That's a really good question. And the truth is, we've passed laws now and have one in California that's been introduced this year to regulate algorithms. The truth is, because it doesn't really give you the choice. I'm sure the young people in the audience understand basically how algorithm works and how your feed works, right? So that is that's why we call the design that we passed a law in California and in England and in Europe called the age-appropriate design code, safety by design. Okay, so the idea is you have to build it in to the algorithms, because the algorithms, the way they were constructed by the big social media companies, is designed to do one thing and one thing only: monopolize your attention so they can monetize your attention and your information for their profit. period, full stop. So the question is an extremely important one, which is, until the algorithmic products are regulated and looked at, you'll never get some of this money. And you are not capable, as an 18-year-old or a 9-year-old or a 38-year-old sometimes, of dealing with what the algorithms do to you. It's why the concept of safety by design is built into many of the coming regulations you're going to see of algorithms, because we are not the same, and it's going to be exacerbated in the age of AI. So it's a very good question, and you will see that regulated in the next year in Europe and Australia, and you'll also see it regulated here in the United States.
Oh, Europe, the origin of the democracy deficit, European Union. Google it, folks. So algorithms put things in front of you, and then you allegedly, I disagree with the premise. You don't have any choice about it. You have to follow through. And some people say they go down rabbit holes and become radicalized, which also is poor evidence for that. There's a question here that's kind of interesting, I think, in general, which is, what if you say that about an adult, someone over 18, let's just say, what does that mean? They're incapable of making that choice despite the ad or whatever, or material. It's just also material. So, and again, some of it's going to be good and some of it's maybe bad, right? They don't have an incentive to give you bad stuff because you don't like it. But for adults, I think the choice is possible. Then there's a question about children and people below 18. And I think in reality is probably Jim might agree with this as a father, is it's developmental. Kids become more and more capable of dealing with things and being rational the older they get. However, that's not the law. The law is, and so there would be a paternalistic interest there for the government or state and local or whatever to regulate. If that were true, right? If, in a sense, we recognize that children don't have an adult capacity to make choices and to reason. But in fact, that's not the law of the United States under the First Amendment. It's the content that determines, and these are content-based regulations, and they're weaker in many ways than the obscenity-based regulations of the 1990s, because that was speech that can always be regulated. These kinds of the speech we're talking about is in fact content and has to have what is called, I mentioned, strict scrutiny. Now there's a term about strict scrutiny, which is strict in theory, fatal in fact. So we can have these discussions, but this is going to, like the other efforts, is going to, I think, ultimately fall at the Supreme Court. In part, what is the case going to be? Some kid that was trying, 15-year-old that was trying to find out about, get information about being trans, is going to be the plaintiff, ladies and gentlemen. Idealism has nothing to do with it. And it has nothing to do with why members are so interested. They want to go to the electorate saying they did something to protect kids. Well, of course they do. The question is not that. The question is, did they actually, all things considered, and within the constraints we have in this country, do something to help kids? Oh, sorry.
I was reminded that the recording does not pick us up unless I have a mic. I have two questions here, one directed to John and the other directed to Jim, so I'll choose these two next. This is for John. It starts out by asking the question, which I think is I'm not sure. It says, was any money harmed is an easy question to answer, unlike quantifying the impact of social media on society. Absent a randomized controlled trial for the counterfactual, is there any evidence of harm that would change your mind or influence your thinking about the regulation of social media?
I just gave you the evidence, right? I agree with that. RCTs are the, because causality is hard. The last two out of the last three Nobel Prizes in economics were given to people who had done fundamental work about causality, because it's hard in social science. But I noted that there's a large study from England by Schabelsky and his colleagues had found that some subgroups of teens were in fact showed negative results, right? So I accept that as, and there's other things too. You see now more and more survey experiments are being done in which you have a control and a treatment group. So yes, I don't think that the liberty to be on social media, to offer that is, and look, that anyone believes anything, you can do infinite harm to others and it shouldn't be regulated. The question is, or is it in some ways stopped, because government does a lot of harm too. The question is, what do we know, how certain is it, and how much overbreath is? My argument is an overbreath here that ties directly into Supreme Court doctrine. I don't think, I would like to, we may agree that the law is, what was it? The law is a fool or something about this. It doesn't matter what we think about this overbreath doctrine and laws about that strict scrutiny has to be applied here. It's going to be applied because that's what the court does. And it already failed in an area where Congress clearly can legislate unprotected speech. So, no, I don't stay away from stereotypes. Yes, I'm kind of a libertarian, though the word libertarian is being used in ways that make me want to repudiate it. I'm a liberal, just an older kind of liberal, right? I'm rational. I'm not some maniac. So I believe that. What I'm pointing out to you is that real studies have shown that there's actually good and bad here. And the problem with the law is that it sweeps everything up, just as at the border, everybody, including the people we don't want in and the people we want in, are being kept out. That's the analogy. No, I'm not talking issues. Open borders is an accusation. It's another one part of our, Cato is supposedly an open borders undertaking. Again, these are words. Find out what the words mean. Find out what the methods are. That's my appeal here.
And Jim, this question is for you. It asks you to consider a hypothetical. If social media platforms were not owned and managed by profit-driven companies, how do you think, or do you think, that would change the need for or type of government legislation?
Well, first of all, they are. And so you should really, let's be honest about it. These are the richest, most powerful companies in the history of the United States and the world. You should remember that. That's actually one of the most interesting things in the work that I do, is that it is somewhat of a David and Goliath situation. Given that, I mean, the scale of, if you look at the six largest tech companies in the world now, America's never had, and the world never had companies with that level of power. So the idea that they would become not for profit and not driven by profit motive is interesting and obviously very hypothetical and will not come to pass in our lifetimes. But do I think that would change the nature of the platforms? I absolutely think it would change the nature of the platforms, for sure, because the fundamental business model, particularly of the ad-driven models, that's when I said to you, you are the product, remember that, you are the product, would dramatically change some of the balancing decisions that executives make. But right now, they make decisions that are based on one thing, which is profit maximization for the companies. And I deal with the people who run all of the big tech companies myself. I would tell you that one of the most important things to understand about the behavior of the companies, that's why I made certain references in my opening remarks about Elon, for example, or about Mark Zuckerberg, or about Sundar at Google, or Neil, who just took over from Susan Wojcicki at YouTube, or Shosey, who runs TikTok, is you have to look at the values and the behavior of the people who run companies. That is actually something I think is important to remember. But the fundamental truth is these are the richest, most powerful companies in the history of the world, and the products that they build are not inherently safe and are not in the best interest of the public. They're in the best interest of profit maximization in an antiquated advertising model. So I think it's an interesting question. It would change dramatically if the motive was something different. And it's exactly why they need to be regulated, because they're not going to do it on their own. And if you think they're going to do it on their own, then I'd look out at Lake Champlain and I'm going to tell you, I'm going to sell you the Adirondack Mountains after the show, because it's as likely as I'll be able to do that as you're going to be able to run a socially conscious social media platform where the profit motive is obviously what drives the business model.
How much do you want for them?
I actually love the Adirondack Mountains. This is the first time I've seen them in a long time.
I don't think even he can afford them. I wanted to respond too, just briefly. We do have a model actually that there are advocates that are making the case for that, which is public utilities. And what you will have is it'll be hard to say whether the company itself is still profit driven. It will be regulated as a public utility is. And the people argue for this are people that say it has all the characteristics of a public utility, but the reason to have it as a public utility is because the content moderation, the regulation of speech online, is in fact is biased against conservatives. Those are the people that want the public utility model. So you can see if you go to a nonprofit model, angels aren't going to come down and run it. It's going to be run by politicians and people, political people with incentives that are political in nature, right?
Alas, this is the last question, and I think it relates to John's remarks now. If content regulation is necessary, which entity, or is any entity, trustworthy enough and non-biased enough to create this regulation?
That's an overly simple question, guys. By the way, I am a con law professor, so I'm resisting responding to strict scrutiny and John's sort of basic level of con law that you're talking about. He's talking about, that's what I teach at Stanford. I'm not going to get into the details of it because it's not a undergraduate con law class here. But the truth is this, this is really not about content regulation. This is about holding people liable for harm, period, full stop. It's really a tort issue. If you're going to go, and some of you are either lawyers or will go to law school someday, it's a tort issue. It's a harm issue. It's not about content regulation. And so you hold people liable for the impact of their products in the same way that Boeing's being held liable, in the same way that car manufacturers are held liable, in the same way that's how we balance harms and risks in society. That's really going to go up in steroids now with the advent of AI. I hosted a conference last week with Sam Altman and Satya Nadella and James Van Yeeke from Google. Satya Nadella runs Microsoft. Sam's running OpenAI. And James Van Yeeke is that guy who oversees Google's AI. This is fundamentally an issue of safety, public health, and how do we balance public health and safety with the best interests of society and a legitimate profit motive. It's not a content regulation speed. It's really a tort and harm experience. And at the end of the day, the best interests of the public are going to win out. It's the fact that we have a dysfunctional Congress in the United States and have had one for more than 20 years has made this much more complicated. But at the end of the day, we will prevail on this. A common sense approach will prevail to social media, and it will prevail with AI too. We will get the benefits of this extraordinary technology and some of the extraordinary minds and human beings who built these remarkable companies, but we'll have a far healthier and more prosperous society, and we will also have a democracy preserved. Because when I look at some of the students in the audience who are the age of my kids, what I'm worried about for you is not just your fears that you won't be able to buy a house and that you're worried about what the economy is going to look like in 10 years. It's really about, will you have a democracy that still operates in the way that I've had the privilege of living in for nearly six decades? And so I would tell you these issues are really, really important in that level. That's why this is such an important discussion to have. And at the end of the day, common sense will prevail.
I disagree with the idea that it doesn't involve content. Now, on the future or content moderation, on the face of it, you can argue about public health and the effects of social media on teenagers. However, notice the actual way you regulate. The way you regulate is you have to give a company a charge to prevent harm, which means preventing them from seeing content. Step at the government's behest, not at the company's behest, but at the government's behest, you step in between people who are communicating with one another. Now, that may be good, may be bad, but it is certainly about the suppression of content, or really censorship of content, at the behest of government. That's why the First Amendment is involved. That's why the earlier attempts at regulation were also struck down. It's just that you can't regulate any other way except, I guess you could vaguely threaten the companies, which might be the way you end up, but doing it. But that's what happens. That's my argument. So John, we disagree.
John, there have been no major cases struck down. This is what I teach. There's been no case struck down in the last 30 years on this. We wrote the video game law, the video game laws. And so they have not been struck down. What has not happened is there's basically been blanket immunity given to the platforms. The way they're going to be held responsible, guys, is once that immunity is removed, they're going to be sued by the parents of people whose kids committed suicide or the people who bought fentanyl or ghost guns on those platforms. Once you remove that immunity, which they got in 1996, and it completely, that's like 30 years ago, guys, 30 years ago, and that hasn't been updated. They'll be liable for hundreds of millions of dollars per offense. Look at the way that the tort system works in the United States. Yeah. When that immunity is removed, that's not a speech issue, that's a tort issue. That will be removed. And when that is removed, they will clean up their act, because it will become too expensive for them to operate the way they're operating right now. Period, full stop. The only thing that has prevented that has been the complete dysfunction of Congress and the incredible power and money of the lobbyists for 6 or 7 giant companies. That's gonna come to an end soon. And that will be a very good day for everybody in this room, for the state of Vermont, and for the people of the United States of America.
So let me give an example of what I'm concerned about here with 230. It comes from my Meta experience. So somewhere there's a contract that probably prevents me from telling you this. So don't tell anyone I told you this. My concern here is that once you get rid of 230, as I said, you give the company, remember, incentives are very important about predicting what's going to happen. Rhetoric is not. Incentives are on the ground. That they, you give the companies, if you get rid of 230, you give them every incentive to take down not only things that they can be said to do harm about, presumably, but also everything else that might be doing harm. Now, let me give you my example. There was a case in the Oversight Board in which a young person had been taken down. And it goes exactly to the drug cases, where Jim will talk about fentanyl, obviously. This is a drug called ketamine, which you may have heard of also. The post that was taken down was from a young man who was not selling ketamine, who was not even advocating its use. What he was doing was talking about his own personal experience with it, that he had used it, that he had had lots of problems with depression. In fact, the depression had been debilitating, and that he had taken some ketamine and started to use it, and he had gotten better. And he said something like, well, I don't know if this is true or not, you know, but I just wanted to communicate my experience with it. I guarantee you, no 230, that post goes down and stays down.
Look, guys, I run a platform with 200 million users on it, right? I'm responsible for what's on that platform.
You run Facebook?
No, that's 2 billion users. I run Common Sense Media, which has 200 million users on our platform. I'm responsible for the content on that platform, right? I'm actually liable, too, for the content on that platform, and we try to moderate that platform. Because even though you probably know it for movie, TV, video game reviews, et cetera, people put stuff on there all the time because of the scale of the platform. I'm actually happy to be responsible for the content on that platform. And by the way, we do have to moderate it. We do have to hire, we do spend a lot of money overseeing that. But that's my duty, even though it's a not-for-profit. So this is not that complicated, folks. This is not complicated at all. And I will tell you, I want to end on a very optimistic note, because the public, thoughtfully balancing all the things that we've talked about today, and as John has articulated really thoughtfully, is on our side. It's clear what's gone on. It's clear what we've seen when you had a completely Wild West environment for 20 years in social media. The damages are very significant. The benefits are also significant. When you limit the damages, as we are capable of doing and will do in the months and years ahead, we will all be better off. And so I actually think that we're moving in a very good direction. I think we're going to have a very difficult election year in 2024, because it's going to be that we are not going to get most of this done in the United States or in countries around the world before the election plays out. And we're going to see a lot of really scary stuff happen. And if I were a young people, I'd really be thinking, a young person like many of the students are, I'd be worried about that. But at the end of the day, we will prevail on this, and we will come up with a balanced approach to social media that will enhance the benefits and limit the massive harms that we're currently dealing with. Thank you very much.
And speaking of limits, I think we'll end it there. Thank you all for coming.